Well, it is officially that time of year again. And no, I'm not talking about pumpkin spice latte, although it is pumpkin spice latte season in Jesus' name. Y'all know how I feel about that. I mean, Starbucks doesn't just award the Pumpkin Pal nickname to just anyone, okay? I'm not talking about pumpkin spice latte season. I'm not even talking about football season. Like, yes, it is football time of year, and yes, our Tennessee Vols did one for all of America last night. Right? It was Roll Cried last night, not Roll Tide. See what I did there? But I'm not even talking about football season. In fact, I'm talking about it's that time of year. It is the election season, the season where there's signs all throughout the streets of our city and ads all over the commercials of our television. You guys know what I'm talking about with these political ads, right? They're the ads that say, one commercial says, "Hi, I'm John Doe, and I love America, bald eagles, and smiling. Vote for me." The very next commercial, without pause, says, "Think you know John Doe? Think again. John Doe hates puppies. A vote for John Doe is a vote against puppies. Don't believe me? Check out this poorly lit photo of John Doe, and you'll know now what I'm talking about. This is election season. And so all across the United States, all across our state and our city here, people are going to the polls, people are voting, people are campaigning because it is election season. And yet, friends, this is one of those things that we don't talk about, right? We don't talk about it at the grocery store. We don't talk about politics at work. We don't talk about politics around our family because why? Politics is kind of the elephant in the room. Now, there's no easy way for me to make this turn. There's no, like, Jesus juke. I can shake something over here, have a little sleight of hand over there to tell you. So I'm just going to come out with it. We're talking about politics today. That was what I expected. Kind of. Because half of you are like, "Karen, he's finally talking about politics. I knew the church was too political." The other half of you are like, see, Kyle, I told you, we finally get to talk about this in church. This is great. Half of you are like, finally, this guy is gonna put the liberals in their place. The other half of you are like, finally, someone will tell off the conservatives. And to all of you this morning, I just wanna say, you'd all be wrong. Let me ask you this, and this is a rhetorical question. Rhetorical means you don't answer it out loud. Don't whisper it. Don't use your inside voice. Don't even say anything. If you're watching online, just be quiet there too, okay? This is a rhetorical question. Do not respond. Was Jesus a Republican or was Jesus a Democrat? Neither. Because Jesus wasn't an American. Shocker. Okay? I know it's a surprise to imagine that, like, Jesus did not look like me. Now, that's not to say he wasn't, like, strikingly handsome and completely ripped like I am. But Jesus wasn't the picturesque Swedish savior who was watercolor painted on the flannel graph of Vacation Bible School. Jesus doesn't look like me, and Jesus, in fact, isn't a Republican or a Democrat because Jesus, in fact, is not an American. And what I want us to do today is to get a biblical picture of how we engage in the political sphere of our culture. What I want us to do is to address the elephant in the room. But I don't want you to start to think more conservative Republican at the end of the day. I don't want you to think more liberal Democrat at the end of the day. I want you to begin to think more biblical when it comes to politics. Now, spoiler alert, I want to tell you right out of the gate, if you hear nothing else, if you walk away with nothing else, I just want you to walk away with this one thing. No politician is going to change the world. No political party is going to right every wrong in our country. Listen to me, church. No candidate, no government leader can actually deliver on bringing the hope that we so long for and actually need. Because Jesus is the hope of the world. Jesus is the one who changes lives. Jesus is the one who changes hearts. And this is so important because if hearts don't change, lives don't change. And if lives don't change, then our city and our schools and our families and everything here in Southeast Orlando and around the world will not change if Jesus doesn't change hearts. We can give away free gas. We can stop all of the wars that are happening around the world. We can pay off all student loans. But if hearts don't change, lives don't change. And life change only happens with Jesus. Politicians, they make grand promises. They over-promise and consistently under-deliver. Jesus, on the other hand, always promises and always delivers. Politicians, government always talks about hope. Jesus always provides and gives hope. Now, just as a framework this morning, we got to recognize that government doesn't actually solve problems. Yes, Brandon, I know that. Can we just go to lunch now and continue to celebrate Tennessee's victory over Alabama? No, stick with me in the classroom for just a minute, because government doesn't actually solve problems. They just manage tensions. And so we've got to wrap our minds and our hearts around this reality that government, presidents, governors, mayors, school board, city council, men and women cannot bring the change that our heart so desperately needs. And we begin to understand and wrap our minds and hearts around this reality, then we'll quit looking to government to do what only Jesus can do. Then we'll quit to, we'll start to live with actual hope instead of just a false hope that refreshes every 2 to 4 years. And so this morning, I want us to address the elephant in the room. How do we live as Christ followers in this current cultural climate? How do we follow Jesus when the world around us looks, feels, talks, speaks, shouts angrily at times the way that it does currently? Now, please hear me say this right from the beginning. Politics is important. I'm not saying that we shouldn't engage at all in politics, but politics is important. It's just not the hope of the world. And so to talk about politics' place in our world, I want us to look at first century Rome, one of the most powerful political empires in human history, one of the most influential governments in all of history. First century Rome was creating and shaping culture unlike any other empire or government political leader in history. Rome, they had a mandate that was unambiguous. Sure, you can worship Jesus. Just make sure you obey Caesar at the same time. Sure, you can worship your God, but make sure that you're also obeying Caesar at every moment. This wasn't a choice for these first century Christians. And so Paul writes a letter to churches spread out all across this massive empire. And he's writing these letters, this letter to these churches to encourage them, but also to shape a framework of everything that Jesus has done. This is what God has accomplished for you in Jesus. This is how he accomplished it. This is the instruction manual on salvation and what Jesus has already done, taken care of, finished for you. And then he starts to take a turn in chapter 12. After he's unpacked all that God has done for us in Jesus, he takes a turn to say, this is then how you ought to live. Therefore, you ought to give your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. He shifts into the way that Christians live because of what Jesus has done. And Paul says this in Romans chapter 12. He says this in verse 9, let love be genuine. Paul is saying, hey, don't just talk about loving people, actually love people. Let love be genuine. He goes on, maybe, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good, hate what's wrong, Love what's right. I mean, this is simple, but Paul is unpacking for these new believers what it looks like to live out the faith that God has given us. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Don't be slothful in zeal, but be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Paul is setting this framework of what it looks like to take a stand for Jesus in our culture. But let me ask you this, what if taking a stand these days means becoming an alternative to the culture, not an echo of the culture? What if taking a stand looks different in our minds than what Jesus actually intended? When we think about being courageous, we think about taking a stand, being strong, being firm, being rooted, speaking up and speaking out in certain times. And Paul would say, yes, yes, but what if taking a stand for Jesus has nothing to do with politics and everything to do with people? What if taking a stand for Jesus is more about love and the love that we give than the laws that are passed in our land? What if it's not about winning a race or winning an election? What if it's all about winning a heart for Jesus? What if being courageous, church family, is more about being an alternative to the culture instead of being an echo of the culture? Last time I checked, that's actually what the gospel is. It's an alternative to everything that we've grown up with knowing. The gospel changes everything about us. And churches that realize this, followers of Jesus, that grab hold of this truth and this reality that the gospel changes us, these are the churches, these are the people who are going to have an influence in our culture today. As Christians, as followers of Jesus, we've got a specific responsibility that we cannot abandon, even though we have and may have strongly held political views. Friends, our agenda in life is to live like Jesus, love like Jesus, and lead like Jesus wherever we're at. Paul begins to frame this conversation, and then he goes into chapter 13, and he says this, "Let every person be subject to the governing authority." Some translations say, "Obey the government, period." Paul here is setting us up to know that, hey, as followers of Jesus, you still have to obey the government, because what was happening in this particular moment in history that Paul was leaning into and addressing was a moment where followers of Jesus were saying, hey, we're part of a different kingdom now, so we don't really have to obey the law of the land anymore. And Paul's like, no, wait a second. Hang on a minute. No, you still have to obey the law of the land, because God established this law. Government has a place. Government has a part in the world that God has established. And he goes on to say, obey the government. For there's no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. Now, Paul's not saying, hey, just follow blindly and don't ask any questions. Paul's not saying that at all. Paul's not saying just, hey, whatever they say, do. Whatever they create, whatever they push forward, follow that. No, Paul's not saying to live a life of sin if that's what the government's calling us to do. But he's also not saying that if we have to close the doors of a church, that the church will stop happening because of anything that's going on in our culture. No, Paul's saying, and he's establishing a theology, that we obey the government. We follow their laws because God has put them in place in the established order of God. And so Paul steps in and reminds this church that's living in the context, that's living in the shadow of the Roman Empire in this culture. And he says, guys, don't forget that God is still in control. God has established everything in our world, which means for you and for me that we need to trust God in every arena of life, not just the spiritual arenas of our life. If you're taking notes, you might want to write that down. We've got to trust God in every arena and every aspect of our life, not just the spiritual and religious aspects of our life. Translation, what does this mean? We got to quit freaking out. God's still in control, regardless of what political party is in control of the House and the Senate. Paul is saying to us that no matter what happens in life, what happens in government, God is still in control. No matter who's in the White House, no matter who's in the governor's mansion, no matter who sits at the head of the table as mayor of our community, God is still on the throne, and he's still in control. No matter what bill passes, no matter what bill gets vetoed, God is still good. But Brandon, elections have consequences. Yes, they do. But no election can change the plans that God has. And my Bible tells me that my God's plans are good. Paul says it in Romans chapter 8, a text that you may need to highlight. You may need to circle with your pen. You may need to just borrow somebody's lipstick on Romans chapter 8 because it says this. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Tribulation? Trials in life? When life takes a turn that you don't want? Is that going to separate us? Or distress? Or persecution? Or famine, nakedness, danger, sword, war? What's going to separate us from the love of God? No, in all these things, Paul says, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure, Paul is convinced. He knows that he knows that he knows. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Friends, I don't know about your Bible. Mine's not written on a dry erase board. This isn't circumstantial in our lives. This truth isn't just true when things are going good. No, Paul reminds us of this because our God is good in all circumstances, under all leaders, under all types of government. God is still good and God is still on his throne. And so we got to trust God. And in moments when it seems like things are crumbling around us, we've got to turn to God, not to our circumstances, but to our Savior. And governments and religious leaders, elected and appointed, they're the ones who put Jesus on the cross. And God said on the cross, even when his son was on the cross, he said, I'm still good. In fact, God did his best work for you and for me when culture and government and leaders did their worst to him. Now, does that mean we just kind of take steps back and just be unengaged when it comes to political and government life in our world? No, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean we just turn on the Wheel of Fortune and live the life that we want to. No, no. We need to vote. Voting is a stewardship of opportunity. If you don't vote, you have forfeited your right to complain. You have an opportunity every election. Regardless of who's in office or who's rotating out of office, you've got an opportunity to vote your Jesus-informed conscience in those elections. Some of you may even need to take it a step further beyond voting, and you need to get involved in local politics, community politics, state, national government. Don't withdraw from politics and elections. Lean into the process, because we have still been called as followers of Jesus. No matter who's in office, we have been called to do everything that we can to create and protect a culture of human flourishing, which is fueled by the love of God. Number one, we got to trust God, regardless of who's in office. Number two, we've got to pray for the leaders, not just your preferred leaders. We got to pray for all of them. In fact, Paul says it this way as he's writing to a young pastor named Timothy. He says, first of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people. Notice Paul didn't make any distinctions here to say, hey, pray for when your political party's in office. He didn't make any distinctions. Hey, when things are going right, then you can pray and celebrate and say, thanks, God. No, in all things be praying for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good and it's pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, this is not partisan, but it is God's plan and purpose that we pray for the leaders who are in office. No matter who's in office, no matter what position they're in, we gotta quit grumbling and arguing about it and begin to pray about it. Because we live in a broken world. And every election cycle replaces a broken leader with another broken leader. Republicans, sinners. Democrats, sinners. Independents, sinners. Libertarians, Tea Party, right wing, left wing, whole bird, all broken. All in need of our prayers to a God who hears our prayer and hears our cry and works when we don't see it or feel it. Amen. Followers of Jesus are called to make a difference. But far too often we settle for just making a point. And no other area of life is this more prominent than in politics. But it's just not the Jesus way. Our posture, our tone, our approach must reflect that of Jesus. Our posture, our tone, our approach has been prescribed to us in Scripture. You have the freedom to choose whether you follow Jesus or not. You do not have the freedom to define what following Jesus looks like. Scripture has already done that for us. And so, number three, when it comes to talking and addressing the elephant in the room in politics, we have to do this. Number three, we just got to follow Jesus. We got to lead like Jesus. This has been prescribed to us as followers of Jesus. The instructions are on the label. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus is right at the beginning of his most famous sermon. And he says this, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works. Hello. Jesus said, let your light shine, not so that they could see your political preferences, not so that they could see what you feel like is right in elections, but so that they could see your good works. Why? And give glory to your Father who is in heaven. How often are we exchanging the glory of God for the glory of a political party? Let's call it what it is. It's sin. How often are we raising up and lifting up and worshiping our own political preferences over our own Savior? Friends, we got to follow Jesus. We got to live and lead like Jesus. Nothing divides like politics, because nothing divides like fear. Church, we got to lead the way regardless of what it leads to along the way and what it costs us along the way. Whenever the church, whenever we as followers of Jesus abandon our Jesus-ordained mandate, whenever we lose sight of our mission as followers of Jesus, we lose our voice. We lose our influence. We lose our opportunity to be the light and the truth and the voice of conscience in our world. Let me just tell you, I'm concerned. In our current cultural climate, I do have concern, because the moment that our concern and our love for country takes precedence over our love for people in our country, we're off mission. When saving America diverts our energy and our focus and our attention and our reputation, when saving America diverts all of that from saving Americans, we've missed it. When we reduce the good news of Jesus to kingdoms of this world, we just become another political group, another party, another constituency, another group of shouting people. And whenever this happens, the thing that Jesus was most concerned about, people, is the thing that we seem to be completely unconcerned about. Truth is, we've fostered division. We fuel division by allowing recent political and cultural mayhem to distract us from what our Savior commanded us to do. And so, our primary concerns, even in the church, often mirror the concerns of our political party of choice rather than of our Savior. And that is one more opportunity, friends, to be divided. Disagreement's inevitable. Division is a choice. Our culture, our nation has chosen poorly, and unfortunately, the church has followed suit. Political polarization isn't new. It's not something that's just brand new with certain politicians or certain campaigns. It's been a national reality for decades. But in recent history, lines have been drawn where lines were deemed unnecessary in the past. And everything has become a point of contention. And what happens is that we get into this, you're either for me or you're against me. It's all or nothing. But every adult in the room, which we ought to be, at bare minimum, the church ought to be the adult in the room. Every adult in the room knows that is not how life works. That when we try to work life that way, it won't work. For the early church, the charges leveled against the early church, the first century Christians, the charges that were leveled against them were that they loved their Savior more than they loved their country. Once upon a time, this love one another culture of the church stood in such sharp contrast to the bite and devour one another culture of the pagan world. Early Christians weren't despised for their behavior. They were despised by the empire for their allegiance to Jesus. Imagine if that were the only legitimate charge against us. We have been called, church, to love like Jesus. We've been called to live like Jesus. And we have been called to lead like Jesus. And when we become so preoccupied with saving America at the expense of saving Americans, we've forgotten God's purpose for our life. Anytime we try to leverage power over love, it's gonna go poorly. You can look all throughout history. Anytime it's power over people, there are problems. Because Jesus never came and said, we're gonna build this great empire. We're gonna build this great nation and come to rise to great political power and make everyone do what we're gonna do. No, no, no. Jesus came and said, we're gonna love sinners. We're gonna teach grace. We're gonna peddle hope and rest for people's souls. So we got to keep our eyes on our Savior. In the midst of turmoil, in the midst of crazy, in the midst of controversy, we've got to stay focused on our Savior. And there's just one Savior, and his name's Jesus. And everybody else, from now until the end of time, will be a letdown for you. 100% of them, 100% of us will let you down. So don't put your hope in anything other than Jesus. Don't find your security in anyone other than Jesus, because everyone else will let you down. And I don't want that for you. And so as we follow Jesus, we've got to learn what it means to be strong, but not rude. We got to be kind, but we don't have to be weak. We gotta be bold and not bully. We gotta be humble, but not timid. We gotta learn to be confident, but not arrogant. And we must learn, church, to not freak out, but to put our faith in the one who always gets it right. So let me ask you this morning, are you willing to embrace Are you willing to embrace the others first kingdom ethic of Jesus, even when it requires you to keep your political opinions to yourself? Are you willing to serve rather than cancel, love rather than demonize, pray for rather than publicly criticize? Are you willing to live for Jesus instead of your politics? Would you pray with me? Father, we are grateful that you've given us clarity on what it looks like to live in our culture in our day. And God, I'm asking this morning that you would begin to reshape our conversations in ways that people see Jesus and not our politics. God, I pray that we would lead the way in loving the way that Jesus did. I pray that we would trust in you, not looking to government to do what only you can do, but truly trusting in you, knowing with confidence that you're in control, that you have a plan, that you have a purpose, even in the midst of our pain. And God, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name.